morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Has everybody been everyone up early, inspired, and I hope had a chance to attend the plenary sessions earlier. My name is Bill Green. I'm the Senior Vice Provost and Dean of Undergraduate Education here at the University of Miami, where I teach religion and entrepreneurship, which is the same subject twice. I said this on one of them. One is for money and one is for more enduring results. And people said, yeah, but which is which? So something you could ponder in your spare moments. I am delighted on behalf of the university and particularly on behalf of the Launchpad, which is sponsoring this panel, to welcome you to this discussion on healthcare entrepreneurship in a changing environment. Before I turn to the leader of the panel, let me introduce Susan Ahmad, who's the executive director of the Launchpad. Where's Susan? Some of you probably know the University of Miami is the only university in the country that treats entrepreneurship as a career path and is an integrated part of our career counseling operation. We have a wonderful network of venture coaches from the local community who help advise our students. We have over 1,500 students who are involved in the Launchpad. It's the largest single student activity at the University of Miami. And in our first 2 years of existence, 45 companies that created 102 jobs, created almost entirely by students and recent graduates, emerged from the Launchpad's work. It's a wonderfully exciting experiment in entrepreneurial education, in life transformation, and our goal at Miami not only is to contribute to the growth of our local community, but also to teach our students not just how to find a job, but also how to make a job. And that's where the Launchpad plays an important role. One of the benefits that the Launchpad brings to the university, we really are blessed by having an extraordinary network of interested friends who help us and who work with us and who advise us. And when we had the opportunity to join in the Global Business Forum and to do a session on entrepreneurship in healthcare, I turned to a person I think is one of the nation's leaders in this area, and that's Tony Masso, who's really put this panel together and is going to moderate it and lead it. And I just want to say a word about Tony, a few words before I introduce him, before he speaks. He is the former president and CEO of Consortium Health Plans. It's a coalition of Blue Cross and Blue Shield plans that offers major employers a complete national solution with comprehensive pricing and cohesive nationwide operations. In this role, he has worked with CEOs and other C-level executives of local Blue Cross, Blue Shield plans and their boards of directors, helping to ensure their national marketing goals were being met. He also serves as an ex officio member of several Blue Cross, Blue Shield association committees to coordinate efficient use of plan resources. Before joining CHP, Tony gained deep managed care experience as Senior Vice President of Aetna Health Plans, where he was responsible for all East Coast operations for all HMOs and POS healthcare plans and managed a budget of $550 million. He's also served as Senior Vice President of the Health Insurance Association of America, where he developed successful managed care networks, and as Executive Vice President of Integrated Health Services, where he continued to develop a successful managed care business by increasing insurance contracts and growing revenues to $450 million. Earlier in his career, Tony served in the public sector as a division director of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, a legislative aide for the U.S. Senate, and as an operations officer with the National Centers for Disease Control. He was also a Peace Corps volunteer. He was educated at the University of Rhode Island and Syracuse University, and I thank him very much on behalf of all of us at Miami and the Global Business Forum for bringing this expert panel together. So please give a warm welcome to Tony Masso.
Thank you very much, Bill. It's a pleasure for me to come here and meet with all of you and for us to exchange among ourselves what does it really take to build an entrepreneurial initiative in the healthcare environment today, which is changing rapidly. Before I do that, though, and I will introduce the panelists, I want to thank Bill Green for what he has done. When he asked me to put the panel together, I said, absolutely. First, I believe in what you're doing with this launch pad, building entrepreneurial activities within the Career Center at the University of Miami is such a wonderful thing to do. Most schools don't do that. I think that Miami is unique in Bill has formed this launch pad initiative. It's really taken off under the leadership of Susan and others. So when he said come and put a panel together, I want people to hear what it's like. I couldn't be more happy to do it, so I'm glad to be here. I believe strongly in entrepreneurial activity, starting at the very basic level. I've done it my whole life. I've done it both as a Peace Corps volunteer, starting businesses in Latin America. I did it later on, even in the government, where I helped launch HMOs and develop private sector initiatives into the managed care environment. And then since then, it's been one healthcare company after another, either starting companies from scratch and or joining companies and becoming very entrepreneurial within those companies. And in that career path, I've been enriched to get to know the three people who are sitting here with me today. I'm going to mention their names and ask them to say something about their background, but also try to lead you into knowing that the people here who I have asked to come with me have actually built their own companies, worked with other companies, big and small, and made a major difference. And the reason is that in healthcare, to have true innovation that comes from change and it comes from starting something and creating a need with a major event that may have changed that situation, like, for example, today. Healthcare reform is a big activity that's going on. That's what we're talking about, a changing environment. What does that mean for the business person or businesswoman who wants to do something different? What new product, what new service can be developed to take advantage of this? We're going to hear some of this. The panelists have a wide range of backgrounds. You've seen bios. But let me just go in the order of which I know these people the longest. David McClain, sitting to my left, he and I started a company managing HMOs and managed care companies in Minnesota. He and I both were on the road building organizations from scratch to develop the changing environment at that time, which was HMOs and managed care. He has since gone on to form new companies, pharmaceutical benefit management companies, specialty management company. He's involved in two right now, where he's the head and founder of them, and he has a wide experience with starting companies, also working with one large healthcare insurance company, United Healthcare, and being entrepreneurial in that activity as well. To my right is Kevin Hutchinson. Kevin Hutchinson and I have known each other for the last 5 or 6 years. Kevin Hutchinson is an entrepreneur. He started SureScripts, a company that develops the linkage between the pharmacy benefit management companies and all of the chain drug stores and pharmacy operations to help bring electronic data exchange into the rapidly changing pharmacy world where it was not prevalent earlier. Subsequent to that, he developed his own company called Primatics, which is an e-prescribing company that he just completed a major transaction with. And before that, he actually founded other companies that he's going to talk to you about and worked on very extensively to change Medalogic, I think is one of them. And he'll tell you about some of those. And to our far left is the guy who really counts up here today. His name is Michael Vindman. He counts because he counts the money. Michael comes from Wall Street. In fact, he took a red eye here this morning, landing at 6 a.m. or so, from San Francisco at the J.P. Morgan conference. And he did it as a favor to me and to Bill Green into the launch pad, because he's going to tell us about, when you look at a company, success and failure are measured by people who count the money. You know, what are you doing to make your earnings? What are you doing for long-term growth? What's your strategy? What's your exit? You know, where will you raise money from? Is it venture capital base? Is it private equity base? What does that really take in order to do it successfully? I've known Michael for the last 6 years, and he and I have been on many panels together. We've met each other. We've talked about companies. We've kicked the tires. We've invested in companies, and he'll tell you a lot about what it takes for the financing of it. So I'm going to stop there, and the first person I'm going to turn to is Kevin Hutchinson to say a little bit more about what he has done. And Kevin, when you've worked with several of the companies, starting them on your own, or developed the last three I know you started on, or others you worked for, because you were at IBM as well, What makes the difference between the idea that works and the idea that doesn't?
Well, therein lies the golden question, right? Because as an entrepreneur, as you start thinking about your ideas, there's going to be a lot of people that are going to tell you they're crazy ideas. A lot of people that will tell you that it will never work. One of the reasons I elected to become an entrepreneur, just by way of background, I came at it a very different way. I spent 10 years at IBM in various different management roles and then moved on to that small startup called Oracle and did corporate development there. And one of the things I took away from the larger business experience is the speed in which decisions are made, the bureaucracy in which decisions are made. I enjoyed my time at both of those organizations, but could feel the need to be able to get out and move along and get into organizations or start organizations in which you can make your own decisions. And along that path, as you look at the various different ideas that are out there and you start talking to people about those ideas, you'll get a lot of, well, let me tell you why that won't work. One, it's been tried before and it failed. Or two, it's never been tried before, and therefore, if it was a great idea, someone would have else would have already thought of it. And those are just two things that you just have to kind of put to the side, because if you're passionate about the idea, you're passionate about the problem in which you're trying to solve, you'll find those solutions and you'll be successful in what you do. They're not always going to work, right? I mean, one of the common things amongst all of us entrepreneurs, and we like to call ourselves serial entrepreneurs when you've done more than one or two of these things, is that you have a very long resume. Why? Because you can't keep a job, right? So you've had very different organizations, some small, some large, some worked, some didn't work. Some you merge very rapidly with other organizations because we need a very broader product portfolio, or others because the timing's not right. There's a lot of things that go into the decisions when you go into making building companies. I kind of look at it from the four P's. One is around the problem. What problem are you trying to solve? And as you look at that problem, you have to start thinking about the product. And the product, what product am I going to bring to market to solve that problem, and in what way am I going to bring that product to market? Kind of the third P in that area is the people. A lot of mistakes are made because you like to start businesses with your friends or your family or cousins. And those are great, and some of those work out, but as long as they're bringing the right skill set, to the table to make it a very complementary partnership when you're starting those roles, that's very, very important. And so as you look at these various different problems that you're trying to solve, make sure that you're committed to it. Make sure that you're passionate about it. Because you're going to get challenged. You're going to get challenged everywhere you go, whether it's by your investors, whether it's by the market. Kind of that last P is the position. When you start assessing the marketplace out there, where does this product fit in the market? Is there someone already out there that's doing something very similar? And if so, how much of that market do they already have achieved and taking? And can you bring another different problem to the market? One of the things that's interesting about Google, and now we all know this great, wonderful success, but Google had a very hard time getting funded. Sounds kind of crazy at this point in time, right? Because it just didn't, a lot of people didn't understand, how are you going to make money? Organizing all of this information and displaying this information, where are you going to make money? And we're going to talk a lot about a variety of different ways of going about starting your own businesses and ideas around that, but I tell you, just stay with your concept, but be flexible. As you set goals, you set priorities for your goals, make sure that you stay flexible because if you think about how antibiotics were created, they weren't created going forward trying to find an antibiotic. But accidentally, as it came along, you keep an open mind about products that might develop along the way. And sometimes I find entrepreneurs that get into a role and say, this is what I'm going to build and this is why. And along the way, a variety of opportunities are presented to you, but you keep a blind eye to those. I just say to keep an open mind because other opportunities that will come along the way, it may not be exactly what you set out to do, but it morphs along the way, and make sure you keep an open mind to those.
Kevin, before I turn to David and Michael, what part does networking with the right people have to do with your career as an entrepreneur?
Yeah, well, one people you want to network with is the guy at the end of the table. So when you're going out to try to find funding for your organization, you need to make sure you're finding the right way in which you finance the idea. A lot of these things are also started with friends and family when you first do to your seed capital, but at some point you're going to need that capital to be able to grow your business, to hire the people, to invest the capital to be able to do that. And there is a, contrary to probably popular belief, there's a lot of money out there that's willing to invest in new ideas. But you just have to find the right partner in which you want to do that. There's a lot of organizations who might say, you know, we're a long-term investor, we're in it for the long haul, we're a very patient investor. That's usually when my red flag goes up, is why are you telling me this? I mean, obviously if you're a patient investor, most investors aren't patient, they're looking for a short-term result. A lot of that depends on the market as well and where we stand in that market, if we're in a down market or an up market. But I have some wonderful relationships with some financial backers, and that comes from the networking and the people that you meet. But Michael's a great example of an individual that understands this and knows where to invest in what quantities and are in it for the right reasons. And so find that investor that you feel comfortable with working through, because one thing that you know you're going to run into, you're going to run into roadblocks. You're going to run into things that you didn't expect. You're going to have failures along the way, and how you react to those and the decisions that you make in reacting to those will determine whether or not your company's going to have a long-term success. And you need financial partners that will stand by you through those ups and those downs of those of any business that you create.
David, to my left, David McLean, has been in the business of starting companies on his own. David, I know that after you and I worked together in Minneapolis, you started a couple of companies in the pharmacy field, clinical pharmaceuticals, I believe, out of Nashville, and then the University of Minnesota, you met a couple of people, university-based, and developed a new company that you're still the founder of and running. And why don't you give us a couple of examples of what you think worked and why, both working for a big company like United and then smaller companies that you've seen succeed recently?
Sure, I'd be happy to, and I'd like to say thank you all for the opportunity to participate in this. As Tony said, my own background, and actually comes out of the pharmacy world. I'm a pharmacist by background originally, and in the early to mid-1970s, I was practicing pharmacy, got involved in the activity in Minnesota that started the HMO industry. There's a couple things I'd like to comment on in that regard as we watch what happens. I mean, for me, in terms of the things I've done, the things that really drive me are not dissimilar to what Kevin's highlighted. It's the issue of trying to identify areas that need to change and identifying the things that you can really get passionate about in terms of driving that change. Because if you're driving change for the right reason in terms of creating better value, that's critical. And if you create value and you create value that others can see, the money will come along. It doesn't always happen, but if you do it in the right way and keep your vision on that's usually the case. I'll give you a couple examples of going back to the early days to the mid-1970s when the early HMOs got started. We were contracting with pharmacies. We were paying claims based on them submitting pieces of paper to us that were handwritten. We began to understand how you need to develop some standards for that. But it took a while for those things to get going. One of the things that actually facilitated this, and it wasn't one of the areas you could plan for, was in the mid to late 1980s, this country passed a Medicare drug coverage bill. And within 12 months, it was rescinded. So that was the first time we were close to covering drugs for seniors. But one of the things that came out of that when that was passed is that the pharmacy industry began to work towards the anticipation of that coverage being there and began to develop some standards. And those standards were ones that would allow the insurance payer and the provider to interface with one another. Well, interesting and lo and behold, what resulted of that in the late 1980s then was the ability of transferring information and transferring claim information. What that has resulted in is the industry called the pharmacy benefit management industry, or PBMs. We now have multitudes of companies in that regard. Benefits expanded. Big companies like Medco, CVS, Caremark, Express Scripts are probably three of the largest. But that all started because of the ability of setting standards and exchanging information on an automated basis. Still is part of the healthcare industry that's more automated than anything else. When you go into a drugstore today, your prescription in most cases is probably already agreed to be paid for before you even walk out the front door. That doesn't exist in other parts of our healthcare delivery system today. But that's one example where it goes back to the early stages of how coverage was being designed, and frankly, the ability of beginning to set some standards in that regard. We developed a company that spawned out of that early 1970s period in doing that, and ultimately sold one of the current big ones. But that was one example. Another example I'd like to give you is where I was a part of an initiative during my tenure at United Health Group. Now, United is a big healthcare company. At the 10 years I spent there, it was probably 10 of the most rewarding professional years I've ever had in terms of changing things. And lots of people think about big companies and they're hard to get them to move, very bureaucratic. In some cases, that's true. But when you look at what you can do with the kinds of assets and the initiatives and the passion that if you put the right people in place and begin to identify how you drive value, one of the things we did was create an entity that was in the transplant area. And transplantation is another one that I'd like to highlight from an entrepreneurial standpoint. Many times we don't think of surgeons as being entrepreneurial, but I can tell you in my career, I haven't found a group of people more entrepreneurial than transplant surgeons. If you go back and look at the early 1950s, 1954, the first kidney transplant was done in Boston. It took another 20 to 25 years before transplantation really started to take hold. But all the early pioneers that began to continue to migrate that clinical expertise with kidneys, heart transplants, the first ones were really done in 1968, 69. Went through a long period of time to get that technique to a more sophisticated level. But when payment systems then began to recognize and pay for these, once the results started to be put in place, we started training a lot of transplant surgeons. Well, all the transplant surgeons originally didn't come out of some training program for transplantation. You know, they had a drive, and they had an entrepreneurial drive. They had a pioneership that really focused on their backgrounds coming out of cardiovascular surgery, GI surgery, and they identified where, in fact, they could obviously extend people's lives by doing these types of surgeries. So we worked at United with transplant surgeons to understand how do we take information and how do we really drive that information to demonstrate what demonstrates best results, best practice, centers of excellence. We then worked with those centers to create that information, collect that information, and begin to demonstrate that to the consumer, be that an insurance company that was paying for it, the patient themselves, or the patient's families. We began to create information that said most people, when they were faced with a critical situation like a transplant, they wanted to stay close to home. But when you start giving them data that shows if you stay at the center that's close to home, your waiting time might be 500 days, whereas you could go cross-country and it might be 100 days. Results, you know, being able to demonstrate survivals, being able to demonstrate complication rates. We were able to build a very sophisticated information system to demonstrate to the reinsurance industry, the stop-loss carrier industry, health plans, but most importantly to patients and families, where the best care was and how we could facilitate that. Being able to change benefits to incorporate travel and lodging benefits into those so we could help facilitate patients and their families moving. All that was done in the context of a very large health insurance company, a very large industry, but the appreciation I developed for transplant surgeons is their entrepreneurial nature. Once they understood what they really had and being able to document their data and their experience, there wasn't anybody that was more entrepreneurial or from a marketeering standpoint, more out front marketing their clinical expertise than many of these transplant surgeons. We had the luxury of working here at Jackson Memorial with the transplant programs for a number of years. People like Andy Tsakas, who's been here at Jackson Memorial as a transplant surgeon, we've had great experience with that. So those are two examples, one from kind of a startup mode, one from a big company mode, but these things also take time. When you look at either one of those situations, either in the pharmacy benefit world or the transplantation world, they don't necessarily happen overnight, but you can begin to create opportunities by again, understanding where change can take place and where value can be built.
What about the brand new company that you're starting from the University of Minnesota. What does that do, this medication management?
Yeah, that company was spun out of the expertise that was built at the College of Pharmacy at the University of Minnesota. The company's medication management systems, but it starts with the premise that patients who are taking lots of drugs are consuming a lot of medical care, a lot of medical resources, not just drugs. People who have five or six different chronic conditions, taking 8 to 10 different drugs, they wind up consuming an inordinate amount of medical care, more excess physician visits, more hospitalizations, more emergency room, urgent care. So we've developed a therapeutic record system that can interface in with electronic medical records, allows practitioners, be they pharmacists, nurses, physicians, to be able to document that activity and start from the premise of identifying with a patient in that type of category what their disease is, what the drug is, what dosages, and what problems are there, and begin to document and record outcomes and improvement. We've published reports that have demonstrated exceptional savings across the board in terms of being able to improve that. So it's one area as we look at kind of the healthcare world today where, you know, we're getting to a point again where we don't have enough primary care practitioners to take care of the patient needs that we have. And as we look at the growing healthcare needs of our population in this country, it's only going to get worse. So the ability of starting to understand where else can we assist with this process? Well, if you take the profession of pharmacy, the profession of nursing, understanding where they, in fact, can take care of patients and deal with kinds of situations that, frankly, we don't have enough time on the part of physicians, physician assistants, many times to do that. And so this company is building a model whereby the technology can support clinicians in better managing patients, demonstrating those results, again, getting back to demonstrating value. I've used the analogy when I speak to in colleges of pharmacies or the profession of pharmacy is that you go back and look at the last 100 years of pharmacy as a profession, first 50 years in the 1900 on was really focusing on manufacturing drugs. That's what the pharmacists did in their little store. The next 50 years, from 1950 to the year 2000, was really focused on the distribution of drugs. What are different ways to distribute those drugs? The focus of the profession in the next 50 years has to be on using information. How do we use information to improve patient care and really drive more value? And that's what we're about in this new company today.
Good. We're going to hear from Michael Mindland now, and then we're going to open it up to all of you. And I want to move from experience, because you've heard my background, Kevin and David's, into analysis. Michael Mindland is a superb investment analyst. I met Michael in New York City at a management conference, and I was immediately impressed with his ability to grasp quickly the fundamentals of any healthcare business and to analyze it internally. Michael has been a portfolio manager for several very large billion-dollar funds, both in Greenwich, Connecticut and in New York City. Since I've known Michael, he's been doing this at three different firms. He goes to all of the investment management conferences. There isn't any company that he doesn't know very well. So when he and I discuss a company, he quickly leaves me in the dark because I can't keep up with his steel trap mind, with his analysis. He's younger than me, he's from New York City, but also he's got the gray matter upstate, not the gray hair, but the gray matter inside the cranium to keep up with the numbers I can. So Michael, tell us from your perspective, which companies have you seen grow out of an entrepreneurial environment and take advantage of something and which ones work from a financial point of view?
Sure, well, thank you, Tony. And usually, I've got to be honest with you, I don't usually speak to crowds this small, but I'll give it a shot. By the way, there's been a lot of finger pointing to the side of the tables. If there's a bag of money back there, I assure you there isn't. I spend most of my time in the public domain, and I've been in healthcare for 10 years in various financial roles, investment banking, equity research, and for the past 6 years, I've been at couple of investment management firms, as Tony mentioned, one in Greenwich, Connecticut, and currently one in New York. And one thing that I noticed that almost every single healthcare company out there, you think of these largest United Healthcare, was once a small company. That 25 years ago was a technology company. And I have tremendous respect for individuals that are entrepreneurs that want to go out there and start businesses. Unfortunately, in my job, I can be both an enabler and facilitator of these businesses, but also the Grim Reaper. And that's because at the end of the day, every good idea is judged by the value that's produced, and that's ultimately dollars and cents. So the one thing that I encourage everyone to, when they think about starting a business, is to think about, is this idea commercially viable? I mean, does it work? Will it generate a return? Where do I get money? Kevin's talked about the four P's, solving a problem, producing a product. Those are incredibly vital to assessing whether this business is going to work or not. There are many good ideas that simply fall by the wayside because they're just not commercially viable, they don't generate money. The world of healthcare is littered with those that have succeeded and those that have failed. And one company that comes to mind is actually, there's a company called Athena Health, started by Jonathan Bush, but it started in the 90s, and it's a healthcare technology company, and each gentleman can certainly opine on it, but this company essentially grew out of a garage to currently generate over $300 million of revenue, growing at 20%+ annually, and sports market capitalization of $1.2 billion. So needless to say, it's made a lot of people very wealthy. What this company basically did, it's revolutionizing the process of billing for physicians. So instead of having, every time you go see a doctor, there's a person that sits in the back and they submit a claim, and many times the claim gets rejected or they don't get paid enough because we've got an antiquated healthcare system with many insurance companies out there. Well, this company designed basically an algorithm that is, people throw out the sort of cloud computing, but it basically updates all the rules for every managed care company out there, enables doctors to bill more efficiently, to ultimately put more money in their own pockets, and this company's profitable as a result of it. So I think having a commercially viable idea, I keep going back to, is very important. Another issue to think about is when you're starting a business is find a strategic partner. Oftentimes, a strategic partner can also be a financial partner. If you think about venture capital, I'm not a venture capital, I don't work at a venture capitalist firm, but I certainly know a lot of people that do, and we do look at investments from time to time. Ownership begets wealth. There's an entrepreneur, VCs will most likely take most of your company, and as these gentlemen also can attest to, as you continue, when you start on the business, if you think you need $10 million, you're most likely going to need $30 million. And by the time you're done asking for that last dollar, you're going to own nothing of that company. So always be very vigilant about the source of dollars, where you're getting it from. And sometimes a strategic partner, I'll give you an example. If Tony knows, Tony's also been involved with the Blue Cross Blue Shield Association for a couple decades at this point, but many companies in the healthcare find a partner in one of the local Blue Cross Blue Shield plans. And it's amazing what happens. There's a domino effect. If one Blue Cross Blue Shield buys off on an idea, and it might take you 5 years to get them to buy off on it, in the next 2 years, another 10 or 20 will do so. In that case, it will not only accelerate the growth of your business, we also have the strategic and financial partnership to succeed and do well. So those are the things that I certainly urge you to think about. And lastly, someone a lot smarter than me once said that a vision without execution is a hallucination. So you have to remain focused, but at the same time nimble in thinking about your business and where it's going.
Hey, Michael, on the execution, it's so Kevin started off by saying persevere, stick with your idea, make it work. I have seen the most valuable determinant of success, the individual or the group of people who decide that they are going to succeed no matter what. Not that they don't have the flexibility to change, but to really make things happen. And I've also seen it, and I want the audience to reflect on, it doesn't just happen by someone going out, getting a bag of money somewhere inside of a company. It can happen inside a company. It can happen in a large company. It can happen in a medium-sized company. Change and make the direction and convince the upper management and the board that you've got a better idea. You don't have to do it solo. I've done it both inside and outside, and I've had as much success inside as I have outside. Kevin, you want to say something about healthcare solutions?
I just want to say something about in healthcare, what opportunities might exist. If you're looking at being an entrepreneur in healthcare right now, it's a perfect time to do it. One of the things that entrepreneurs are drawn to, on the water, is chaos. And if you can find an environment where chaos exists, then you find a lot of entrepreneurs walking around trying to find ways to solve that chaos. And there is nothing more chaotic, as we all know, than our healthcare system right now, and has been for a while. That's changing rapidly. I spend part of my time sitting on President Obama's Healthcare IT Standards Committee, where we're trying to establish the technology standards that will be used for the interoperability of healthcare to move patient information around and do good. That's a challenge because there's a lot of standards out there and everyone has an agenda for what standards should be, one that gets established over the others. But if you look at the chaos inside of healthcare right now, we're all consumers of healthcare. And one of the things interesting about healthcare, it's got its own ecosystem, is that the consumer of healthcare is not typically the purchaser of healthcare. So then you have the purchaser of healthcare that is either our tax dollars under Medicare, Medicaid, or it's your employer, or there are private, that we have your own insurance as well. There's a movement toward that. But the people that are providing the healthcare typically don't know the cost of providing that healthcare. Mm-hmm. So you've got a product where you're not established price. You don't know what it costs to actually deliver that. You've got a consumer who doesn't really pay for it. And the ultimate person, organizations that are paying for that, have finally said, this is enough. You know, it keeps going up and up and up. I need the quality to rise. I need accountability, you know, for that care. And you've got consumers saying, yeah, that's great. I want quality. I want accountability. But I also want more. There's the demand for healthcare continues to rise. So anytime you get in those chaotic environments, opportunities just breed. And there's one environment that seems to be getting most trends right now within the opportunities, and that's the patient-to-physician relationship, the patient-to-provider relationships moving toward an online environment. And I'm not talking about just online visits. There's a lot of that that's existing out there. But care management, care coordination are two very, very important areas within healthcare right now that they're looking for ways to improve both care management and care coordination. And all of us as consumers would welcome that opportunity. We're seeing more, and there's studies that are out there, you can find them very easily, on research about mobile applications. I'm a technology guy, so I'm coming from a technology bent, where mobile applications and consumers, as well as providers, are looking for these mobile applications to enable them to have a better care coordination. We're all tired of going to that next physician or that next specialist and filling out the same paper forms that we just filled out 20 minutes earlier, or running the same lab test, or having the same blood drawn because those results aren't shared amongst those. The interoperability, the standards that are being created right now in healthcare that are going to allow the interoperability and the sharing of the patient information is going to open up lots of opportunities for solutions that can be brought to that marketplace, and something to keep in mind.
Thank you. On behalf of the Launchpad and Bill Green, he said he wanted you all here in the audience, part of the university, to look at what entrepreneurial activities can mean for you. And so I'm going to now throw it open. You've heard experience, you've heard financial activity, you've heard potential opportunities.
We have a mic, so if you just raise your hand, we'll get a mic to you.
The floor is open to anybody up here, or a general question or something.
Mike, I'm
sorry? Yeah. Oh, go ahead.
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank you for taking part in this forum and for your great experiences. I have a pretty specific question. We're currently seeing mostly out-of-pocket payments for services for people with pre-existing conditions. From an entrepreneurial point of view, how do you see the healthcare providers, whether they're going to suffer or benefit from the healthcare reform, especially the ones who provide services to those people with pre-existing conditions?
Let me just take a crack at that. I think that providers have a unique way, physicians, hospitals, and others, to find innovative approaches to any big change, even if it seems negative at first, and that the benefit tremendously by that. Primary care physicians, particularly, are going to be in greater demand and need. So the primary care physician population that we have today is not adequate to take care of the increasing demands of both the population, the increasing ability of people to be insured, and the elimination of pre-existing conditions, because the healthcare reform law pretty much does away with that. So I think there's good opportunity for providers in this healthcare reform activity if they organize and take advantage of it. Anyone else want to do that?
Well, I would just bring one thing up that is an idea from an entrepreneurial perspective. One of the reasons why pre-existing conditions are a problem is because of the frequency in which we change health plans. As employers, as an employer myself, we're changing health plans probably every 2 or 3 years because the rates get so high, we find a lower rate, we move. Well, the conditions by which a plan might service my healthy population, they don't want to drive a lot of preventative care in there, because who benefits from that is whoever the next insurer is going to take care of those patients. It's been very difficult. If there's a way in which an organization could help balance the risk of those, both from a healthy population as well as pre-existing condition, across multiple payers, be that, you know, your self-insured or be privately held insurance, then you could actually see the pre-existing condition problem go away. Because if I can benefit from the patient prior to them having that condition, and I can lower my risk from the patient post them having the condition, then I'm going to be in a better lane. Now, that requires a lot with respect to getting cooperation, coordination across the industry.
Let me also comment upon that. I think one of the things that creates an opportunity for providers and provider systems now in those kinds of situations is the information system. You know, providers, physicians, nurses are not necessarily trained to take care of populations of people. They're trained to take care of a patient. But now we have information systems that can demonstrate to a general internist, if they generally have 2,000, 2,500 patients, now we have information systems that can begin to show kind of how that care is broken down, kind of where the pluses and minuses are in terms of where they can focus their attention as managing a population of patients, and where in fact they can begin to bring some more standardization. So I think, you know, in 30 years ago, insurance industry tried capitation, providing risk payments to physicians. One of the reasons that didn't work very well is that there wasn't information to give to the doctors. They didn't have information systems. Well, now we're beginning to do that. Many things Kevin talked about in terms of government facilitating standards to make that happen. I think we'll see some of those.
And I'll just add one thing. So it is, you know, we have the inherent problem with our healthcare system is that 20% of the people generate 80% of the cost. And that's part of the reason is because we as Americans are conditioned to believe that more care means better. Okay, that's really not the case. And what healthcare reform brought to light is really that, you know, we should be focusing more on pay for quality. You know, my business, I am paid simply on how well I produce. That is the bottom line. If we make money, we make money. If we don't make money, I don't make money personally. So unfortunately, we don't have that in healthcare. That is why it's a $2.5 trillion industry. And simply because of an aging population doesn't make it a growth industry because we have a funding crisis. So I think anybody in healthcare that's focused on cost containment will have a successful business, because today that is the buzzword. Can you affect the trajectory of the healthcare costs? That is it. And so if there are solutions, such as information technology, that can put more information in the hands of the doctor, then you will have a successful business.
Next question.
Yeah,
Well, anyway.
Okay. I have a question. I have a healthcare staffing company and figured out how to increase the chaos of healthcare, and that is by working with the Immigration Service. So we specialize in bringing in people that are foreign educated or working with foreign educated folks here. And we've just added a new service line. We're in therapy as well as nursing, but healthcare IT staffing. So Kevin, this question is more for you. A lot of the providers that we're speaking with know it's coming. Obviously ICD-10 and HIPAA requirements are a little bit more defined. But as far as healthcare reform and the IT systems and meaningful use and being able to deliver to 88% of the hospitals within the timeframes that are currently in the Affordable Care Act, I mean, how do you see this market evolving for, you know, entrepreneurs and staffing hospitals?
It's a great question. I'm going to get on a soapbox a little bit here, because given that I'm part of the problem, I'm trying to be part of the solution. I actually am schizophrenic on the topic. Since I sit on the government board, we're trying to establish meaningful use and the criteria by which we're going to have that rolled out, the dollars rolled out. But at the same time, there's a lot of things coming out of meaningful use that I don't agree with. One of my companies previously was a company called Medicalogic Medscape. And Medscape was a physician portal. We sold it to WebMD, and still their physician portal today. Medicalogic was one of the largest electronic medical records at the time. Now it's GE's. We sold it to GE, and it's called Centricity. A lot of those systems, with no disrespect meant to my fellow entrepreneurs in that space, those electronic medical record systems that we're deploying to these physicians today are very dated. It's old technology. It's technology that was built in the 80s and the early 90s, and it's been continuing to be enhanced feature function-wise. A lot of that electronic medical record software was focused on the actual documentation of care while you're in the practice, while you're in the exam room, but not on the interoperability of sharing that information amongst other providers and hospitals and labs and other things like that. It focuses primarily on, that's a physical exam, I'm going to fill out the physical exam, low back pain, I'm going to fill out low back pain. I'm going to store and create your record electronically. Well, great, because I'm going to go right down to the next physician who's going to create that same information again, asking me the same questions again, storing their own record. So we're trying to now establish this interoperability. What's very interesting from an opportunity standpoint is, just like I was one of those guys that was Quicken 1.0. I was typing in all of my information in Quicken and putting it, and then I was putting in my checks in the printer, and I was printing the checks and signing, because there was no electronic access to banks, right? It was taking me 3 or 4 hours to pay bills, you know, when I could just write a check and pay only 20 minutes. But I wanted everything electronic inside the computer so I could do graphs and show my wife how much we're spending on credit cards. That, by the way, I don't recommend that for anyone. No good that comes out of there. So the point is, now there's opportunities being generated because people are coming. I've seen some really incredible companies coming to the table now who are trying to solve this electronic medical record problem, but not with an old mindset, particularly around social media. What if I invited my doctor to join my network? And what if it was like a Facebook for healthcare, where I'm in control of my healthcare data, I invite my physicians, I invite my hospitals, and they join me as the patient? What if the center of healthcare was on me, not on all the various different physicians? And what if physicians actually had to use that data for purpose of care? So there's some very interesting company, and the side benefit of that, by the way, is all the documentation has to come out, but it's available to other physicians as well. There's some very interesting technologies and approaches to the electronic medical records coming out that are designed around social media. I'm not suggesting that one's going to work where you do the invitation thing, but the concept of social media and controlling that information and sharing that information amongst other providers, other hospitals, even other care providers. If I'm elderly and I have a care provider, a family member, they want access to that information. It's a different way of solving the same problem.
Can I help? Okay, next question right here.
I work with GE Capital, and I totally agree that there are enormous opportunities out there. But I'm just curious on your insights, which ideas that seem like reasonably good ideas, now that healthcare reform is beginning to take shape, are probably not such good ideas. Sort of looking backwards a little bit at ideas that either the problem went away or the reimbursement to solve the problem went away. Just curious if some of your ideas thoughts about things that are going that are probably not going to go.
Good. Let me mention one, and I'm going to ask everyone here to mention a different one. And it piggybacks a little bit off what Kevin just said about engaging the physician and the patient. Today, consumer engagement is a huge opportunity. Health plans in reform who have a patient population do not want to lose that patient population to a healthcare exchange when they become effective in 2014. They want to keep that population within their own system because they don't want to lose the revenue, premium income. So consumer, again, how do you engage the consumer, all of us here, to have a sticky attachment to whomever today is covering my healthcare? And how do you get the consumer to play a role and to give the consumer new information so that he or she recognize they're getting some benefit from the insurance carrier that's taking care of them, in addition to just someone paying bills? That is huge. Opportunities exist all over the place. I ran into a company recently, I don't know if it's gonna work or not, but they came up with the idea just with seed capital from a few friends and family, and then just raised a small round of VC money to send coupons for healthy activities and healthy foods to individuals that health plans are categorizing as people who need to change their habits. So that the and all of the coupons and all the mailings come not from the company doing it, but come from the health plan. It would be like the University of Miami Medical System saying to all of you, you know, you're going to get this regular mailing of all these incentives and all these dollar savings because we give it to you because we want you to stay within our system. I mean, I don't know if it's going to work or not, but it's one way. Another way of consumer engagement is through the web-based portal system, where the consumer can link in and actually use the system to his or her benefit, but it's brought to you by a sponsor who has an inherent interest in your welfare. So consumer engagement is one. Dave, is there another one you can mention?
I think along that same line, we were talking back in the back room before we got started, you know, and I don't want to pick on a part of the industry, but you know, when the disease management industry started in around 1990-92, a lot of that was funded out of the pharmaceutical industry, validly so, to say, you know, if we're going to sell drugs to people with chronic illness, how do we support identifying how we can do a better job of taking care of those patients? Well, it's been difficult because what I refer to has been kind of the silo effect. They've just taken, okay, let's identify all the diabetics, let's send information to them, let's call them, let's have people show up on their doorstep. Everybody's trying to do everything for that diabetic population. Well, when you look at diabetics, they don't just have diabetes. They might have two or three other chronic conditions. And so I think one of the things that's come out of that, the disease management industry is kind of remaking itself. It still is in transition. But to answer the gentleman's question from GE Capital, I wouldn't bet on anything kind of historically around the lines of trying to do kind of silo management of diseases. It's got to focus on the patient and kind of getting to what Tony and Kevin have talked about in terms of engaging the patient.
You know, I guess a couple of points. One is there's been a lot of, we shed a lot of light on information technology, and I keep going back to our funding system, and look, dollars will follow innovation and entrepreneurship, and while a lot of these ideas, let me play devil's advocate around social media and healthcare sound great, at the end of the day, as long as the doctors and the providers get paid for touches, then the incentives are ultimately misaligned. And at the end of the day, who's going to pay for all this? Who's incentivized? That's why out of healthcare reform, it excites me most are a couple of concepts. One is the concept of comparative effectiveness, which is really looking to see, you know, we've got, you know, 20 different blood pressure reducing medication. We've got 10 different statins. And we've got tons and tons of drugs and medical devices out there. And frankly, there's very little clinical differences among them. And so and the costs are outrageous. I mean, if you think about the margins, which is what I focus on, the other day, dollars and cents of many of the pharmaceutical companies, medical device manufacturers, they're 30 to 40 cents on the dollar. I mean, a hip and knee implant costs $5,000 to a consumer in the United States, consumer being both us through higher premiums and health plans and employers. It costs about $1,500 to make. And the costs continue to escalate. Think about technology. You know, 15 years ago, I bought a computer, and you know, it was a Pentium 286 that cost $2,000. Today, I can get a laptop that's probably 100 times faster. It costs about $500. Healthcare is the only industry where technology continues to get better and better, but the costs continue to rise. I have no idea why is that. So that's one. And the other aspect of it is really accountable care organizations, which is really, you know, gentlemen before it was talking about, you know, managing individuals with pre-existing conditions and chronic patients, and that's really it. To me, that's really the answer to solving this sort of 2080 puzzle. It's really making the providers all accountable for managing the care of a particular individual and ultimately designing a system that's going to reward them. You know, today when you go to a doctor and your blood pressure rises or falls, your doctor doesn't get paid more or less. He just gets paid more to see you. Well, to me, there's a fundamental difference.
Okay, in front of you.
I think the part of the problem that you touched upon is who really owns the medical record. The patient really owns the medical record, but the problem is that Epic really doesn't want to talk to Cerner.
Right.
Cerner doesn't want to talk to GE. There's semantics problems that are in healthcare IT that right now aren't solvable, to my knowledge. You know, there's a problem called deep emotions that University of Pittsburgh invested $87 million in to try to get their legacy systems talking. I don't know where that stands, but until you can get the patient to actually own their record, and until you get that data into the patient's record and into all these other systems, you're stuck. You still have these silos. Even the hospitals, they have the same type of systems. If you have Epic or you have Cerner, you don't want to talk to the other hospital system that has Epic. And you know, the insurance companies, they want to own the record. Mm-hmm. So whoever owns the record controls the patient. The patient owns the record, then
yeah,
they control the record.
Yeah, let me make a response to that. In full disclosure, I'm on DB Motion's board, so I know a little bit about what DB Motion's doing, right? It's not going to be up to the vendors anymore. Being one of those ex-vendors with MedicalLogic, which MedicalLogic and Epic at the time, this was back in the mid-90s, were going head-to-head for all the 10 to 20 physicians we could find that were requiring EMRs at the time. And now the vendors have to be certified by the federal government. So to some degree, there is at least, from a positive standpoint, someone stepping in and saying, you know what, I pay for 50, 60% of healthcare costs. So I'm going to start requiring certain things to happen. One thing that happens in healthcare is, and it's interesting, both good and bad, if you want to follow trends or see where a direction's going, wherever Medicare ends up moving toward, you see a lot of private insurance organizations move somewhere down that same path from a requirements standpoint, because there is the big dog in healthcare costs. But Epic is, you know, a large hospital information system, physician office, electronic medical record. They have lab ordering capabilities, Cerner, the same kind of enterprise-wide healthcare systems. And you're right, you get in these multi-systems, and these technology companies don't want to communicate with each other, because if I communicate with you, you can replace me very easily. Because if my data within my application can be moved very easily, I can be displaced very easily. It all becomes about cost, right? So for years and years, decades, this battle has gone on about not sharing information. Can't do it anymore. If you're going to be certified from the federal government, you have to be implementing the standards for interoperability. You have to be able to share that information. That's what's going to change over the next few years. The battles with the vendors are basically over. Because if you're going to be, no physician, no hospital will use your system unless you're federally certified. And there's now 5 certification organizations, and the vendors have to go through and prove that they have this interoperability capabilities. There's still a lot of work to do. There's this thing being built out called the National Health Information Network. Very, very, and we're part of that at the federal level, unstructured right now. Some people believe the National Health Information Network is going to be the government's going to run that network. The government's made it very clear they have no intentions of doing that. We all know the National Health Information Network is going to run across the internet, just like banking, right? It's not going to be some other, there's not going to be another network that's actually going to run that. But what opportunities as an entrepreneur will come out of that? Because there is going to be standards going to establish the National Health Information Network, but the use of that data for good, to drive quality, to drive improvement, to drive patient satisfaction, to drive 2 big categories of things, care coordination, care management, are huge opportunities that are still undefined right now.
Okay. I have a question. Yeah. Can you comment about the difficulty of primary care physicians trying to implement a medical record because there's so many products out there? Number one. Number two, the cost of it is not cheap. And it's an ongoing cost, and the reimbursement to us, the primary physicians, as stands right now, is very low.
Yeah.
The third thing I want to talk about is the HIPAA regulations about data that we share. What protection do we have in regards to that? And the fourth item is the medical liability in the healthcare reform. There's nothing that relates to curtailing that medical liability. That's what possibly the health cost goes up because of that, because everybody's practicing some type of defensive medicine to protect our livelihood, I guess.
Thank you. Well, from an EMR perspective, most of you may know that part of the Health Reform Act, which, by the way, I don't think that's actually health insurance reform. We haven't reformed, to Michael's point, we haven't reformed the way we pay for care yet, or the way we control the cost of care. But part of that was to give physicians up to $44,000 per physician for the adoption of electronic medical record systems. And those have to be certified electronic medical record systems, which are all going through a certification process now. But to answer your question about how does an individual physician practice sort through all of the, which one do I buy? Unfortunately or fortunately, a lot of it is word of mouth, in the sense of, you know, a doc who acquired one, they like it, they don't like it. By the way, the vast majority of physicians who have implemented EMR systems don't like them. So, but they know they have to have them. So it's a problem, because it is changing the way you do workflow, which is not something that physicians like to do. They do not like change. They don't like inserting a different way within the workflow within their own practice. And those systems, as I said before, were built a while back. There's some better ones that are coming to market now that I think will go through the same certification process. But from a how do I pick it, there's been across all the country now, it's entirely covered, called regional extension centers. And these regional extension centers, there'll be one in Miami, there'll be one in the state of Florida as well, are helping to establish relationships with a variety of different EMR companies And you as a physician can actually use the services of the Regional Extension Center, which is federally funded, much how the Farm Bureau funded local Farm Bureau organizations to help farmers. These regional extension centers have been set up to help healthcare industry, and part of that is to help in the selection of an electronic medical record system. So I encourage you to reach out to your local regional extension center, and many of them have already established relationships with electronic medical record companies, and they provide support and training implementation assistance as well.
Michael, what about the issue of liability? What protection the primary care physicians have today that they didn't have? I don't think there's going to change that at all.
Well, we have some poor reform in some jurisdictions, but look, clearly the problem is physicians can practice defensive medicine, and that fundamentally reform hasn't tackled that. So, you know, we've seen a lot of attrition, and in terms of EMRs, I mean, a lot of, I know, you know, a couple of cardiologists in New York City were saying, you know, they're in their, you know, late 50s are saying, look, you know, the CMR, and I'm shutting down, I'm quitting my practice. So you've got not only a shortage of physicians, but we've got a lot of doctors that are going to retire early simply because the demands are onerous. And frankly, you know, when they're facing annually a potential 20% reduction in Medicare reimbursement, putting in a new, sort of buying a new gadget isn't really top of mind for them. So, you know, having said that, let me give you a little brief on the stock market. The publicly traded companies, the servers of the world, have done incredibly well since the High Tech Act, which is the Information Technology Incentive Act, was passed in February 2009. They're probably up, down about 100-150%. So whether that's all in anticipation of investors like me hoping that there will be this inflection point and the buying by the healthcare community will begin, and we're still waiting, but it hasn't happened, but stock prices are going up. So here's something, here's an example of a concept that people believe in it, but really haven't seen it play out. And, you know, I'd love to hear more from Kevin and David as to what they think. Is there going to be an inflection point when all this information technology buying is going to take place?
David, what about the HIPAA implications of the primary care?
I think that's a real one, it's a critical one, and I really appreciate the dilemma that providers are in. I think when you go back and look at the origins of HIPAA, you know, it's a train that got off the track. The original intention of HIPAA was to create portability of information when it was originally talked about, and it turned into a privacy of information stuff. You know, we spend more money, billions of dollars in this country on HIPAA now, when in fact some of us might worry more about our financial information personally. And we don't spend anywhere close to that in kind of the banking world. However, I think one of the things that we need to push is need to understand, you know, to Kevin's point, as EMR systems are kind of still the vestiges of how they were originally developed, they need to focus more on supporting the process of how practices operate. And again, most of it was originally all back office, and that was good, took a lot of paper out of the system. But when you have to deal now with processes of dealing with HIPAA on an upfront basis, dealing with all those things, and also dealing with now clinical decision support. You know, there's not a lot of clinical decision support technology in EMRs to support clinicians in helping to facilitate their decisions, be it about a particular patient or a population of patients. So I think those are the kinds of things that if the federal government's going to push, provide incentives for providers to do these things, I think the vendors have to be pushed by, whether that's the government or the provider systems themselves, to say, help us fix our process, because our process right now is broken. If we're going to have to have this thrust upon us of HIPAA, we need to have a better process to be able to manage that.
Right here.
Yeah, could you speak to the prospects of innovation around payment reform?
Everybody here in the back, can you hear the question?
No.
Innovations about payment reform, is that your question?
Yeah, you've kind of alluded to using healthcare IT to document value and making kind of an argument to payers with respect to, you know, we're providing value, can you pay us with respect to that value? If your assertion is correct that reform doesn't sufficiently address some of the payment issues, what can entrepreneurs do to facilitate the change from sort of volume-based purchasing to more value-based?
What can entrepreneurs do to focus in on value-based versus volume-based?
Yeah, and kind of using the technology that we have.
And technology, okay. If you didn't hear the questions about payment.
Yeah, let me take a stab at that and give you an example. My day job, I'm CEO of a company called Novologix, and we provide information technology to the insurance industry to manage those drugs that are paid for under medical benefits. Very high-cost drugs. These are drugs that cost anywhere from $5,000 to $10,000 per administration, but they're drugs would have to be administered in physician offices, home health environments. But in one of the things we have developed now to address something like that is, if you look at the field of oncology, there's been a tremendous amount of clinical development documentation done by oncologists with treatment guidelines, treatment paths, very, very detailed. Unfortunately, not a lot of that has gotten automated to the point where it can be accessed, used, and kind of built into EMR systems. And one of the things we've had on the payer industry is payers have been requiring oncologists to jump through all kinds of hoops with prior authorization, submit stuff, submit paper. Really hasn't added any value to the process. It's created more problems for everybody that has to touch that. So one of the things we're involved with the industry right now is beginning to push and change the model whereby if we can just document what pathway electronically that an oncologist is going to use for a patient, and then be able to allow that provider to demonstrate their adherence to that pathway, there have been some studies done that have shown that there's as much as 15, 20, 30% savings by beginning to practice according to guidelines. Milliman, which is one of the big actuarial firms in the country, has done recently a study early last year that just said, you know, don't worry about trying to measure all kinds of outcomes. Just focus on the fact that in oncology, if you just start measuring the guidelines that clinically have been developed, start measuring adherence to those and documenting those. Well, our systems haven't electronically been available to do that. Well, now we're starting to. Now we're starting to have some input in that. So the benefit there is benefit to the payer as well as the provider side. Gives the provider an opportunity to document and to say, you know, we're following the guidelines of the clinic that we think are absolutely the best ones. And by that, we're going to eliminate variation, we're going to eliminate complications. And to the payer side, they're eliminating all kinds of administrative burden that, you know, is actually drives them crazy. I don't know whether that helps or not.
Yeah.
In the back, way in the back, we've got a question.
I was just going to make a comment that up in Missouri several years ago, we passed tort reform. I don't think it's had a great deal of effect on defensive practice, but it has certainly helped to control our Med-Mal insurance rates, and it's also helped with availability of our ability to recruit physicians to our area. So I think tort reform is something that the national powers should look at, and I don't think they're much interested in that at this point.
I couldn't agree more, and you're absolutely right. Maybe when states take an initiative such as Missouri has done, it certainly may not affect defensive medicine, but it does reduce malpractice rates. Obviously, we know what the problem is nationally. It's politics. I mean, it's got all to do with tort reform. It's a political hot button, and that's why people steer away from it. Because they want to get something passed, and just don't want to get the trial lawyers and others involved too much in it. It's pure politics. It has nothing to do with healthcare, of course, which would be lower. Question here.
As you see healthcare reform coming in over the next few years, what opportunities or trends do you see in medical offshoring and companies going self-insured with fully insured products?
There will certainly be more. There's already some offshore activity going on, and it will be enhanced. I haven't studied that particular aspect of Reform Act very explicitly, but in terms of self-insurance, many national employers today are self-insured, and I see that they will maintain or increase self-insurance. And the burden is going to be switched, I think, from employers who are insuring everyone today to the government and the national exchanges covering some of the people whom the employers, for cost reasons or because the individuals will have an option, will choose to opt out of. So there could be opportunities for entrepreneurial activity in getting involved in what the state exchanges will be doing in 2014, in creating areas where people can migrate from their current employer. University of Miami is a big employer. It covers healthcare for its staff and faculty and others. You know, individuals will have an opportunity to leave that system and go somewhere else. And there could be business opportunities for everybody.
When you mention medical offshore, you mean getting care obviously outside the United States, right?
Yeah,
sure. Well, I thought
right, and that's, you know, that's been around for about 15, 20 years. You know, the hubs of that out, you know, Singapore, there's some, you know, beautiful hospitals out in Southeast Asia. I think what's driving that, look, I've looked at a couple of private companies actually have great facilities in Cancun, and you know, if you go there for a very nice stay and, you know, bring your spouse if you like and hang out on the beach while you're getting your, you know, hip replaced. I think what's ultimately going to drive it, there's some legal barrier, because are you using U.S. doctors? And if you're using U.S. doctors, can they bill, you know, will the insurance pay for it? I think what's driving that is one way that the insurance companies have looked to reduce healthcare costs is by increasing the burden on the consumer. So while, you know, premiums going up 10%, the employee, the individual's portion might be going up, you know, 2 to 3x that. And so as the deductibles continue to increase, as your out-of-pocket costs increase, I think people seek those alternatives. I think with healthcare reform, look, I think we'll continue to see a larger burden of healthcare costs fall on us as individuals. I still don't think it's a viable solution. I'll give you an example. HealthNet, which is an insurance company out in California, they have a Salud plan which caters to the Hispanic population in the state, and many of them, as well as, you know, can go across the border and get some very good primary care in Mexico. So there are pockets of that, and I wouldn't really call it offshore, but sort of en masse flux of people getting across the border and getting on a plane. I just don't see that growing.
Question here in the middle.
Yes, going back many, many years, and Kevin, I'm sort of addressing this question to you. You've been working now on this IT technology. David Brailer came in 2003, I believe, and was the first IT director to come up with standards. So it's been 7 years now, going on 8, that they've been trying to develop standards. Why don't we take all the money that we're doing to do that, all right, let's take just maybe 1/10 of it, give it to 10 engineers out in Silicon Valley, lock them in a room for 6 months, all right, and let them divide up $100 or $500 million between them and develop the standards and get over with it, because it's going on way too long, and it's all political between the companies, between my friend here from GE, the Cerners, and everyone else.
Amen.
let me respond
just real quickly to that. I don't disagree with you at all. This is I was on President Bush's commission that was driving standards as well, and I'm a Republican, and I got transferred over to the Democrat effort as well. I will tell you though, even though I'm a staunch Republican, under this administration, there has been more focus on it. I think, and David was on my board of my last company, and great, great individual. Smart, understands the market, knows where it needs to go. Dr. Blumenthal is now running that David Brailer was running before. And there's been a more focused effort around standards in the last 2 years than there was previously, not because of effort, just because of motivation around the Healthcare Reform Act, forced by federal legislation to establish those standards. We didn't have that previously. We didn't have the legislation. We didn't have the motivation. The vendors, which, you know, being one myself, we were never going to agree. Someone had to step in. The parent had to step in and say, thou shalt, and that's what's been happening over the last 24 months. Now the problem is, in establishing those standards, there are a lot of them out there, and I didn't realize this going into it. The politics between the standards organizations, HL7, NCPDP, all these various different standard groups, is very, very large. The standards organizations actually are not necessarily directly at the table in making these decisions now. So it's being made in a different forum of organizations that are represented by hospitals, represented by physician groups, represented by consumers, represented by individuals that are part of the healthcare ecosystem. There are vendors at the table as well, but not necessarily overwhelmed by the vendor influence in this particular case. So I think that we will have those standards. They're out there for phase one. Phase two will be done in 2011. Phase three will be done in 2012. And now the focus is on this interoperability. So there's strong momentum in that regard.
We have a question waiting right here.
I'm a physician who is looking for a way to repackage the services that I can provide from being patient encounter driven to more disease management driven, and be able to integrate the knowledge and the power of the prescription authority in a way that is more in tune with the technology that is coming out that would allow us access to information that comes from different sources through web-based tools. And I wanted to see if, you know, Michael, if that's a resource that has been identified as an on-tap area, you know, just creating a mechanism for physicians to resell their services in a different model than this, you know, patient encounter-driven system that is really failing.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not, let me try to address that. You know, there's some physicians who've gone to the concierge model, which is they simply stopped taking Medicare, Medicaid, and insurance patients. They simply said, look, I'm going to provide care for 200 patients, and I'm going to be at their beck and call. They can email me. Here's my cell phone number. And that's one way to go. I'm not dealing with the headaches. It's all private pay. That's sort of been, now, clearly that's, you know, that's not something that can be transmitted to the whole country. Talking about, again, physicians, and these gentlemen might be a better source, sort of looking out and developing some systems to provide disease management to their own patient. The question I, as an investor, would always ask myself, look, this sounds great. How are you going to get paid for it? I mean, the question you always have to keep going back to is, look, all of this sounds great, but until we have a mechanism in place to reward you as a physician for what it is that you're doing, it might sound great, you might even save someone some money, but are you going to make money personally? Or is this something that we can transplant? Is this something that we can scale? So these are great ideas, but again, are they commercially viable?
Let me also address that. I think there's two things that are being both funded, and there's also been pilot work done in various parts of the country on this. One is the accountable care organizations that are being talked about, which are primarily larger, big delivery system, hospital-based entities that obviously incorporate the physician services within that. The other is the medical home model. There's been a lot of work done with that. There have been a lot of national panels and advisory groups that have made recommendations back to CMS. There's been a lot of pilot work, and there's grants that have now been provided in various parts of the country to do that. And some of the results, I've seen results and heard people speak about what they've done with the medical home concept, but it basically is that. It's basically saying to a physician, take a population of patients, we're going to reimburse you in some manner, whether that's on a historically a capitated model, we're going to reimburse you for taking care of this population of people. The one thing that we have not addressed yet is what's the information system that's going to allow you as a physician to be able to really take care of that population of patients. But the medical home model probably comes the closest to looking at kind of new innovative ways. CMS does have funding. ARC is funding a lot of these things as well in terms of looking at kind of new models to test.
I would give you some examples of companies that you might want to look into. There's one that's actually spun out of Microsoft called Healthy Circles, which is a very interesting company that establishes a electronic relationship between you as a physician and your patient population. First of all, let me applaud you for trying to take the initiative to actually change the way you're delivering care, because that's big. That's what we need. We need more of that kind of entrepreneurship in healthcare to show that it works. There's another one out of Boston called American Well. These are all startup organizations that are trying to support physicians that are trying to change the way that they're interacting with their patients. It's interesting, unlike lawyers, you know, physicians are not reimbursed for every minute of time that they spend with their patients. When I was building Surescripts and we connected all of the pharmacies together in the industry to be able to allow electronic prescriptions to go to the pharmacies, one of the things that came clear in that process as we talked to physicians about it is, while it's a necessary evil for them to renew medications, when you call your physician and say, I need to get a prescription renewed, that's time lost on that physician who's not able to reimburse or be paid for that time spent, unlike, you know, attorneys. American Well, Healthy Circles, and these other type of organizations are trying to change the dynamics by which patients are willing to pay something to have that level of a relationship with a physician. Could go as far as concierge medicine, or could be some, you know, hybrid to be able to support that.
We'll take a few more questions, but I want to mention the name of one other company doing something like this that you might want to contact. It's called bestdoctors.com. Mm-hmm. It's a company formed out of Boston. They link physicians and patients with diagnosis. They don't do patient comfort. They look at the best potential treatment, and it's a company started by a couple of physicians out of Harvard Medical School about 10 years ago. They do $100 million of revenue now. Only 23% coming to this country, really taking off by matching the physician with the diagnosis, not the patient. Okay, more questions.
Given problems ranging from Tucson to the aging population and the growing number of cases of Alzheimer's disease and other problems, what do you see as the future business implications of mental health services and how they fit into the whole medical model you described?
That's another very big area which I don't think we paid enough attention to, and I can't give you specific examples of that. I know there are a lot of companies that are formed around managing behavioral health care. I don't think that's what your question is addressing, because their companies are trying to cut the slice out of the providers to deliver, you know. So I won't mention that, but I really don't have a good response to mental health.
I mean, we passed mental health care legislation, which is certainly going to help things. Unfortunately, there have been a lot of failures on the Alzheimer's side when it's come to providing new therapeutics, and that's been unfortunate, because we've made a lot of progress in cardiology, infectious diseases, but oncology, but really Alzheimer's, we're really lagging. The one area that I see some development in is, but a lot of long-term care facilities, nursing homes, are really providing, and assisted living facilities, are providing, are building out specialized Alzheimer's wings. And I do think for individuals that are, you know, sort of progressing along that timeline, there is some help along the ways that they can be these sort of localized units where they can get the help they need. But you're right, we're absolutely lagging in our ability to tackle Alzheimer's, and the onset is coming. I mean, baby boom started aging in 12 days ago, and you know, 20, 30 years from now, you know, a lot of us will be down that road.
One quick thing in that regard, I think as we talk about the shortage of physicians in various areas, geographically and special areas, I think the shortage in geriatrics is critical. You know, there have been so many people that have gotten into that field left because financially they couldn't make it, and that's where the expertise is needed most, and we need it even more.
And we're not paying for that service. There's a question in the back. Someone has a microphone.
Considering that there's going to be more and more needs for primary care physicians going forward, but how do you see the survival of the solo practitioner in this healthcare environment that is more driven by technology and expensive computer systems? Because solo practitioners tend generally not to have the resources to acquire and operate those systems.
Kevin wants to answer that, but let me say that I live in a small town in Maryland, and I see a solo practitioner. My primary care physician is a physician who operates his own office, his wife is a nurse, she works there, and I see him struggling to keep up. He's probably close to 60 years. I think he's just going to fold his practice when he's done. And I think it's a shame, because I wouldn't be going to him. I could go anywhere. But I like the care I get, but the ability of a solo practitioner to keep up, as you say, with what all of us have been talking about, is unfortunately very limited. It's a struggle. It can be done, but I don't think too many young people are going to go into solo practice because of that very problem. I mean, how do you keep up with everything? How do you manage to study, learn, buy equipment? It's pretty difficult to do.
I would just say that I'm on the board of an organization called TransferMed, and it's owned by the American Academy of Family Physicians, and they're focused on how do we convert the small primary care practices into medical homes. So how does that primary care physician become the center of the patient's world, where I as a patient say, you're my medical home. And at that point, my primary care physician coordinates my care across. Now this kind of, you know, sounds like it's going back to the gatekeeper, the managed care. The difference is, I'm choosing who is my medical home, where my medical home lies. It's yet to be determined whether or not that's going to be successful or not, because it all depends on whether the government, right now United and some other health insurance companies are actually paying physicians extra bonuses to establish themselves as that medical home, because they're seeing very positive results in the elimination, duplication of tests, elimination, duplication of a patient waking up and saying, you know, my back hurts, I think I need to go to a chiropractor there, I think I need to go, instead I call my medical home, who decides what my next treatment path should be. You see improved care, lower costs. So health plans are actually paying bonuses for these medical homes right now, but it's not all across the country yet. It's still in pilot form in many places. The other thought I would say is, there are these virtual accountable care organizations that are being developed with the center of, the, of small practices being at the center of that. A lot of people know Kaiser Permanente. Well, that is one massively large accountable care organization that are all employed under the same umbrella. But you're seeing partnerships and organizations come together in communities creating virtual accountable care organizations, and a lot of those being centered on the small practices as being the start.
It's still difficult, though. Reimbursement is increasing.
Yes.
It's still difficult for solo practitioners to keep up with technology and buying equipment.
It is.
And just the last comment on that, we've seen a tremendous increase in hospital appointment of physicians, and I see that trend continuing. And also, as most of you know, in the room, primary care, it did experience a resurgence when the HMO model was alive and well in the mid-90s, and unfortunately when that failed, a lot of people driven out of that specialty, and you know, I was looking at some data. I mean, today less than half of medical students that graduate actually go into primary care. So that is, you know, that's something that needs to be addressed.
I'm sorry that we're out of time. I know there are a lot more questions. The Launchpad is delighted to have brought what I think is a panel of extraordinary interest and ability. Please, thank Tony Madison.